friends. Today, we are on the 48th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series, and we are nearing 50. And to mark this momentous occasion, we have none other than the former Chief Justice of India and former Chairperson of the National Human Rights Commission of India, Justice K.B. Balakrishnan, sir, with us. Along with that, we have also the privilege of the presence of Justice V. Ramkumar, Justice Nagamuthu, sir, Justice Sidharama Murthy, sir, and all of you who have been on a journey together. So without any further wastage of time, we can directly go. I mean, why we assemble today is to hear our Lordship speak on a very, very important, though broad subject, an overview of CPC. Sir, over to you.
So good afternoon to all of you. Mr. Prem Raj, a few days back, called me and told that they are having a Zoom conference. I thought that the participants are young lawyers from Cochin, but now the old giants are before here.
Old bandicoots.
Talk about the CPC. I will be carrying call to Newcastle. So he suggested some topic, but it is difficult to talk on a particular topic. But I will say some of the salient features of CPC. That is one of the most ancient, prominent law which every lawyer on the civil side should know. So I will just talk about some of the very, very, very important, just glance through the provisions of CPC. The right, I will, with the permission of all of you, I will straight away go to the subject. From the definition part, you just want the definition part two. The decree, you must know what is a preliminary decree, final decree. What is the decree? The decree means it should decide the rights of the parties. Rights of the parties determines the rights of the parties with regard to all or any of the matters. And it could be final or preliminary, as in partition suit or mortgage suit. There would be final or final decree or preliminary decree. And it is also important to note that the an order of dismissal of but it shall not include any adjudication from which appeal lies or as an appeal from an order or any order of dismissal for default. So that is only just about the decree. Then there are series of definition. I don't want to go into the, but you must know as a civil lawyer, you must know what is mean profits, the mean profits, which is often comes in civil litigation. A person in unauthorized possession received the profits, and the plaintiff is entitled to receive what that is mean profits. The property means the mean profit which person in wrongful possession of such property actually received or might with ordinary diligence have received therefrom. If he himself improved the property and received something, that will not include mean profits. But the plaintiff is entitled to record mean profits. Then you must also know about what is the very detailed definition has been given for public officer. You must glance through the various public officer, because this is relevant, because some of the documents are produced. If these are from this office, it amounts to public document. So it has got the evidentiary value. That is the public officer also. You must pay attention to these definition. Rest of the definition, all you know. Then we come straight away, a series of various provisions. I go to only touching the important portions. Section 9, only I think I would be able to pay attention to some of the sections, not the order section part of CPC. Section 9, the only thing you must remember that court shall have jurisdiction to try all suits of civil nature, excepting suit which their cognizance is either expressly or impliedly barred. All civil nature, the court has got jurisdiction to try. Some of the matters, for example, cooperative society, education matters, they are especially in the statute itself, the suit is barred. So except those matters, the civil court has got jurisdiction to try, as it is a civil nature, that is the... Then section 10, 11, they are important from the point of view of the stay of suit. You must pay attention to that the stay of suit. No court shall proceed with the trial of any suit in which the matter in issue is also directly and substantially in issue in a previously instituted suit. You must pay attention to the directly and substantially issue in a previously instituted suit between the same parties or between the parties under whom they or any of them claim litigating under the same title. You must know, as a young lawyer, you must pay attention to what is this litigating under the same title. So suppose if the head of the family is instituting a suit on behalf of the family, or it is binding on all the members. So that is litigating under the same, between same parties, parties under whom they or any one of them came. Even though in the previously instituted suit, he is not named as the defendant, but they are the named as the plaintiff, he is litigating under the same title. So that is important, that expression, you must take note of that fact. Inside the having jurisdiction to grant the relief claim or any court beyond the limits established, that court should have, it should not be a revenue court, which has not, evidently may not have jurisdiction to try the suit. So it is not the court which is previously instituted suit should have competent to the jurisdiction to try that suit. That is also relevant. These matters also relevant in the matter of the next section, section 11. Yeah, everybody knows what is res judicata. You must know what is res judicata. No court shall try any suit or issue with the matter directly or substantially in issue has been directly and substantially issue in a former suit between the same parties. Same expressions are used, between the same parties or between parties under whom they or any one of them litigating under the same title. Here we have to pay attention to some more facts. It is the explanations. The former suit shall denote a suit which has been decided prior to the suit in question, whether or not it was instituted prior thereto. If the suit need not be instituted prior, but the decision must be subsequently previously. And it is also the matter about a suit must be in former suit have been alleged by one party and denied or admitted expressly or implied by the other. That is the implied res judicata. That is also, you should pay attention. What is implied res judicata? Suppose his party has not directly pleaded, but he ought to have pleaded that matter, but he did not plead. But it is deemed to have been the res. That is, any matter which ought to have been made a ground for defense of our attack, and such matters shall be deemed to have been matter directly and substantially in issue. So some relief is claimed in the plain which is not expressly granted by the decree. It be deemed to have been refused. So these are all matters which you should know. What is res judicata, which is very common. We must, for those who write examination, law examination, this section 11 is very important, because this is all the nuances of section 11. You must pay attention. The implied res judicata, litigating under the same title. Then whether it ought to have been raised, all explanation. There are 8 explanations which are important. Where persons litigate bona fide in respect to public right or a private right claimed in common, that is also important. Provision of this section shall apply to proceeding in execution of a decree, that is also relevant. Issue heard and finally decided by a court of limited jurisdiction competent to decide such issue shall operate as res judicata. If the court is competent to decide that limited jurisdiction but competent to decide that question, then that also that order part the that also would judgment or order would also become res judicata. For the foreign judgment, I am not the it's not very often raised when foreign judgment not conclusive. The it is important in that sense that these are all the grounds on which the an award is nowadays the award could be set aside the court where the it has not been pronounced by the competent court. So the it is against the incorrect view of international law or refusal to recognize the Indian law, where it is against the natural justice, where it has been obtained by fraud or breach of law in force in India. So these are all the grounds where the foreign judgment is not conclusive. These some of these are the same grounds which is used in the Arbitration Act to set aside the an award passed by the court. The, you know, even a, any court, some of the recent, some of the even Indian court, these against the Indian law, against natural justice, it is a court of the has not been pronounced by a court of competent jurisdiction. These are all the then the foreign judgment is not binding on India. They will not so. Then 15. Court in which the suit is to be instituted, every suit shall be instituted to the court of the lowest grade. All these facts, everyone knows. I do not want to spend time on the suit to be instituted or subject matter. So where the suit is to be instituted, whether it is immovable property, the whether defender recovery of immovable property or with the subject to the pecuniary limits prescribed any law for the suits, shall be instituted in a court within the local limits of whose jurisdiction the property is situated. If it is a property related to immovable property, the suit must be instituted in the where the property is situated. But the if the defendant, if it is related property is situated and the court within the local limits of whose jurisdiction the defendant, where the suit to obtain relief in respect of compensation or wrong to immovable property, if the defendant resides the this expression also you should pay attention, where the suppose the defendant is the defendant actually and voluntarily resides or carries on business or personally works for gain. These expressions are repeatedly used in the matter of execution, execution of a decree, execution when the decree is transferred. All the this expression is quite often we come across that the defendant actually and voluntarily resides or carries on business or personally works for gain. So these you should pay attention. Some of the expressions are repeatedly used because the you know because the you must pay attention to that. Suits for immovable property. Sometimes the difficulty arises the whether the court has got jurisdiction. Sometimes the villages are changed from one district to another district. From another district is bifurcated. The former new districts are bifurcated. New that the court's jurisdiction is changed. Then what is to be done? Some doubtful jurisdiction. Whether the we do not know whether the same village our suppose the property in dispute is situated in a particular village and that village is tagged on to the nearby district which had so it lost the jurisdiction, but the plaintiff may not know, the even the lawyers may not know what is the revenue the ordinance on revenue audits are passed by the revenue authorities. So the court what day is the we can make a statement to that effect in the plaint and file the suit. The defendant can dispute the statement. Then only thing is that the defendant, if such a statement is made, then the defendant has not raised that any objection. In fact, it has not jurisdiction. Then the defendant has not raised objection. He cannot in the appeal or revision, he cannot raise objections. Suppose the plaintiff failed to make a statement, even then the appellate and revisional court may not go into that question. This, so the defendant can say, no, 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 plaintiff has not made such a statement. But even in under such statement, suppose there is no failure of justice and the court, then local limits of jurisdiction, normally regarding jurisdiction, the question is to be raised at the earliest point of time. Even non-jointer parties, misjointer parties, it should be raised at the earliest point of time, before the settlement of issues, at the time of settlement of issues, these objections are to be raised. Sometimes it is not raised, but if there is a failure of justice, that is often stated in all these sections. If there is a failure of justice, court will consider, even though it was not raised at the earliest point of time. Objection to the jurisdiction should be raised. No objection as to place of suing shall be allowed by any appellate or revision court unless such objection was taken in the court of first instance at the earliest possible opportunity and in all cases where issue are settled on or before settlement. But even then, there has been failure of justice. The no objection to the competent of court with reference to the pecuniary limits of jurisdiction also. This is said. But it is unless there has been consequent failure of justice. Then the court will pay attention to such objection and will consider such a. Otherwise, it is the court will not allow. Then sometimes the suit can be transferred. Section 25 is a Supreme Court transfer suit from one court to another to court of the power to transfer suit, which may be instituted more than one court. The court can transfer the suit from one place to another. That also you must, whenever the opportunity arises, that is important. The service of summons, when the service of summons, order 5 is there. That is also, you must pay attention. These sections are only incidental sections, power to issue summons to the witness. But you must, that is in the order I will add. Then the interest, the cost and compensatory cost, you must know what is interest. Interest on the principal amount adjudged till the filing of the suit, that is one portion of the interest. Then the interest pendentiality, that is from the filing of the suit till the decree is passed. Then the future interest, from the decree till the payment. All the three stages of the interest is payable under Section 30. The court can, order the interest. But only one thing is you have to pay attention is interest provided where the liability in relation to some so adjudged had arisen out of a commercial transaction, the rate of such further interest may exceed 6%. Normally, the future interest can be or interest ordered by the court is 6%, but it's a commercial transaction. The dispute arose out of a commercial transaction and the plaintiff, because his money, the defendant's plaintiff's money has been deprived of his money by the defendant's action, and he has made use of that money for commercial transaction and made profit out of it. The defendant, the plaintiff can recover the interest at the commercial rate, which is the further interest may be exceed 6%. The commercial, the bank rate, he can recover. The cost is a discretion of the court, and the court can, extend the court are to be paid. So that is, where the court directs that any court shall not allow in the event, the court shall state its reasons in writing also. The court should give reasons in writing. Then 35A, the newly added, it was added some amendment also had taken place. 35, this is also we read along with we have striking down the pleading. The false, frivolous or scandalous allegations are made in the plaint or the pleadings. the court can strike out pleadings. So just as the these are the powers given to the court to impose compensatory cost in respect of false or vexatious claim or defenses. Suppose they even the false claims are made by the plaintiff, or the defendant may raise a false or vexatious claim. Vexatious claims, you mean the unnecessary claim based on the court has got the power to strike down that pleading and also impose cost. But there are some limitations are imposed. No court shall make any such order for the payment of amount exceeding. Now the amount is 3,000 rupees or exceeding the limits of pecuniary jurisdiction, whichever amount is less. Then if it is a small cost court and all these the restrictions are the, then the 35B for causing delay. Suppose a party is asked to produce witness and he has not produced the witness, or he was asked to take certain steps, he has not taken the timely steps, and the suit had to be adjourned. So under 35B, court can impose a cost. Then that is the. Then part two is the execution. Execution. The important thing is to be remembered that the execution is to be read. You must also read along with the relevant order, which is the decree is the definition of which the court which passed the decree has got the power to execute the decree. Which is the court which passed the decree that effect shall in relation to the execution decree, where it is anything repugnant to this. So where the decree to be executed has been passed in the excess of the appellate jurisdiction also is considered as a court which passed the decree. The decree could be transferred. Suppose the defendant is residing at a place other than the place where the decree is passed, then the decree could be executed and the decree is to be transferred to the place where the defendant works for gain or carries on business or patiently works for gain. Or suppose the property is situated at a distance, is outside the jurisdiction of the court which passed the decree, then the only the money could be recovered only from the by this attachment and sale of that property. So the decree has to be transferred to the that court. Then suppose that property is to be sold, that is outside the limits of the jurisdiction. Suppose the family has got property or a theater, cinema theater, which is outside, or flour mill, which is outside the jurisdiction of the court. It is to be sold and it is to be partitioned. So the court has to transfer the decree. So that is the power is the court which passed the decree on the application of the decree holder send it for execution to another court. So that court has got the take steps. But before the transfer, the decree court can also the attach the property of that attach the property which is situated outside the jurisdiction of the court which passed the decree. Only thing you have to remember that such an attachment will be last only for 2 months, and you will have to, before that, you have to take steps for sale of the property or get extension of that extension of the time of attachment. That is usually called precept. That is also you must be conversant with these proceedings because the decree executing has got quote, certain powers, the legal represent dispute regarding the legal affairs, power of the executing court, section 42, whether legal dispute regarding legal representatives, the court can power to send decree for execution, power to execute the decree. These are all the powers of the executing. The transferred court also has got all these powers of execution. So the precepts comes under section 46. These are all which the ordinary civil lawyers will be conversant, and you will have to frequently use all these provisions. So we may not get time to go through all these relevant provisions. Only thing that these are all the matters which you should be able to pay attention. Then the powers of the court to enforce execution by delivery of property, attachment and sale, arrest and detention, by appointing a receiver or such other manner as the decree. That how they so a decree is to be executed by the delivery of property. But the direction the decree is to be so retained. Suppose something is tangible property is to be retained. That is to be complied with. That is the mode in which the suppose the property is receiving income. So appointment of receiver and the income is to be collected by the receiver and paid to the parties. Then arrest and detention, separate provision is there for arrest and detention for such period. If it is a money decree, the arrest and detention detailed provision is there. The person could be arrested. The plaintiff has to make application. He has to deposit he has to pay the subsistence allowance for but there are separate provisions. And that also, we have to arrest and detention, section 55, we have to, detailed procedure is prescribed for arrest and detention of the, but we must also know that there is a prohibition under section 56, prohibition of arrest of detention of women in execution of a decree for money. If it is a money decree, we cannot execute the detain a woman for the. Then how the arrest and detention is to be executed, the no outer door should be broke open, but if already entered the house, then suppose the defendant is in a room, that room could be broke open. Then suppose a woman of Pradhanishan lady is inside, she must give. All these are a common thing you must be. So once he paid the amount, the judge and debtor paid the amount, he must be made to release from custody. These are all common matters, which is the substance servants should be paid by the plaintiff, that rate will be fixed by the government. So there are some certain, every person detained civil person in the execution decree shall be so detained, where the decree is for payment of sum of money exceeding 5,000 for a period of that scale is prescribed. But one thing is to be, in order to arrest the plaintiff should prove that the defendant has got means to pay the money and he is purposely evading the or he has recently disposed of properties to defeat the degree holder. All this he should he should give evidence. Then only the court is satisfied. Then only this arrest and detention that is a relevant order that is of the rule under order is prescribed. So then section 60 is very important. What are the property liable to attachment and sale in execution decree? So this is if a judicial officer, he should pay attention to what are the items of property which is liable to be attached and sale in execution of a decree. There are certain the items of properties which is though valuable, which is shall not be attached. The following property is liable to be attached. That is the government securities, bonds, and all but you must pay attention to property which shall not be liable for attachment. Sometimes the civil judge junior division commit mistakes in attaching property which is not liable to be attached because the tools of artisans, where judgment is an agriculturist, his implements of husbandry shall not be attached, necessary wearing apparel, cooking vessel, birds and weddings, then the houses and other building which is appurtenant thereto. Suppose it is a house is situated in a property and it is the appurtenant house and the appurtenant building belonging to him shall not be attached. Then books of account, mere right to sue for damages, right to personal service, stipends and gratuities, wages of laborers, domestic servants, these are all not liable to be attached because it is a civilized way of execution alone is permissible under the CPC. If it is salary to the extent of first 1,000 rupees and 2/3 of the remainder. So first 1,000 rupees cannot be attached. When the remaining out of the 2/3 also not liable to be attached this salary because he has to make a living out of that money. So if their money is attached, he will not be able to be able. So they wanted all these compulsory deposits, all deposits, other sums derived from any fund, pension, interest and lease, residential building, any allowance. All these are all the things when attachment application is filed, judicial officer should carefully scan the application and find that it is not hit by any of the exempted categories under section 60 of the CPC. Do not commit mistakes in these matters. Either in procedure law, if you commit mistakes, so that will be very serious, so many such incidents have happened and created problem for judicial officers. Though otherwise very honest and sensible, intelligent judicial officers, but they commit small mistakes. So then sometimes the supervising the judge is very strict. He may find fault with the occasion. I got a series of the incidents I remember, but I don't have time to narrate those stories. But these are all matters which only thing that the CPC basic ideas you must have thorough ideas about the CPC. CPC, Indian Penal Code, Criminal Procedure Code, and Evidence Act. These four statutes, if you are a judicial officer, you should be thorough with all the four statutes. Lawyers can afford, they have got time to peruse, study when they're discussing with the clients and all the, again, but judicial officer, time is short. So whenever there is time, they should make thorough with all the important and relevant provisions of the CPC, CRPC, Evidence Act, and Indian Penal Code. There is no day you will not have excuse they are not actively practicing in the court. So then it appears that they may not have experience about what day-to-day happening in the court. When if they go to the court and they know whatever, all these provisions are day and every day it is being used. So in the CPC. So the section 60 is important. Incidental proceedings or to initiate a commission to examine person, section 75, we must know that make partition accounts, local investigation, examine all these commissions are, court has got power to issue commission to another court also they can quote. Then they come to section 80. That is very important. Young lawyers should know section 80 notice. Previously there was the section 80 notice was there, but now unless the section 80 notice is issued, the suit is filed. They can suppose some urgent orders are required. Some building is going to be demolished. Some shop is going to be demolished. Something is injured. They can file a suit, but the court will hear that. Maybe instituted with the leave of the court without serving any notice as required subsection. But the court shall not grant the relief, the suit, whether interim or otherwise, except after giving notice to the government. So the government leader will come and appear and argue. Then only they will not straight away as just as any injunction suit. Though in such a circumstance, the court is satisfied after giving the parties that no urgent or immediate relief need be granted in the suit, return the plaintiff for presentation it after complying with the requirement of subsection. So that again the plaintiff has to issue notice, then after 2 months he can file the notice. How the notice is issued, if it is against the railway, against the central government, to whom the notice is to be issued. Only thing that the what is the issue between the state and the party should be stated clearly. So the description, place of residence of the plaintiff, all the district collector or the chief secretary who reads the notice must be able to understand what is his problem. So that the notice should contain all these details. That is section 80. Section 80 notice is very important as far as a young lawyer is concerned. So don't go straight away. Go and file the suit. The suit will be thrown out. So that is also. Then exemption from personal appearance, some of the. But here, for persons specially appointed by government prosecutor, some of the notice shall not be issued. Exemption from arrest and personal appearance in a suit is a defendant shall not be liable to arrest nor his property attached. Some of the suit against foreign rulers and ambassadors, there was a very incident where one judicial officer issued notice to the king of Iran. He ordered notice, the Hertag issued notice and created a huge problem long back, probably in 1991 or 1992. So then when the government of India called the High Court and informed, then only they realized that the such a notice was issued to the head of a state, because it is casually it happened, because it is so it is impossible for an officer to peruse every case title and know. He only puts initial issue notice. So the office, without knowing all these things, issued notice to a head of state, and the by post it went, and then the diplomatic people, the government of India immediately alerted the High Court, taken steps and all. So all these things happened, that too in Kerala it happened once. Then the settlement dispute outside the court, arbitration 18, this is a new provision, which is arbitration, conciliation, judicial settlement, mediation, all possible under the new era. So you can also, especially from family matters or any matters which is likely to be settled, the court has got power to refer the matter for arbitration, conciliation, or judicial settlement, including settlement of Lokadalat. Then section 92 is important. Those who are fairly senior lawyers will know what is the 92. The scheme suit, we call, sometimes it is referred to as scheme suit. 92 section, if it is charitable, the trust, we cannot straight away, somebody cannot file straight away file suit. But normally suit, the administration of such, the advocate general or two more persons having an interest in the trust, having obtained the leave of the court, may institute the suit. Otherwise, if the advocate general is the others also, those who are interested in the matter also can file suit. So various, the suit, trust is created for a certain purpose. The trust itself, original purpose of the trust itself is have been as purpose is fulfilled. So the trust may have properties, what to do. Then a new scheme is to be prepared for which the suit can be filed. Such a suit is called a section 92 suit. Whenever somebody approaches you as a lawyer, approaches you to file a suit against in the matter of a trust, you must carefully go through the section 92 of the CPC. Then only then I don't want to read the need to go through the various provisions, appointing a new trustee, removing a trustee, vesting any property of trustee for the original purpose of trust, provide use of any matter relating to trust. Suit to be in tune with section 92 of the CPC. Now, larger, these type of cases are very much in state of Tamil Nadu. Trust properties, 92 suits are very common. So, family trust dispute arose, then the trust properties. Trust suits are filed as scheme suit, it is called. Then appeals from original decree, the supplementary proceedings and an appeal may lie for an original decree passes part in. And so that is not very, we must know what is no decree to be reversed or modified or error irregularity not affecting jurisdictions. 102nd appeal, you must pay some attention. If only there is a substantial question of law involved in the case, then only the substantial question of law itself is to be stated in the appeal memorandum. In an appeal under this section, the amount of appeal shall precisely state the substantial question of law involved in the appeal. Where the High Court is satisfied that substantial question of law is involved in the case, shall formulate that question. High Court also formulate that question. That is what that is the in the case of the second appeal. Then the powers of the appellate court. These are also, they can finally decide the matter, remand the case. He can frame issues and on certain issue, if it is felt that the relevant issue or no issue was framed and the court had not paid attention to that dispute. So issue can be framed and remitted back to the court and take the appellate court can take evidence also. Sometimes the evidence also is taken by the appellate court. These are all the powers of the appellate court. So then the reference review and revision. Reference is not ordinarily being done. I have not come across any case reference. If any validity of any act, ordinance or regulation or any provision contained the act, ordinance or regulation for the case, opinion of that court ordinance is invalid or inoperative, such an dispute or controversy arises, civil court can refer the matter to the High Court. But the party normally will couch the relief in such a way and will file an Article 226 petition. So why should he file a civil suit and the municipal had to refer the matter to the court? So the normally either the way in which the public interest litigation, other litigations are filed nowadays, even R32 is invoked in all matters, 226 in varied matters. So nobody would venture to challenge the provisions of any act, ordinance or regulation in the civil judge before the civil judge junior division. So the municipal court. So such a reference is not. The revision, the powers of the High Court, revision is maintainable even the jurisdiction, the trial court has not exercised the jurisdiction, not vested in it or failed to exercise jurisdiction or have acted in the exercise of jurisdiction illegally or with material irregularity. That is also the revisional powers of the court. Then the High Court has got rules, can revise the rules. The High Court, not having being a High Court of Judicial Commission, may from time to time after previous publication make rules regulating their own procedure and procedures report. I think Kerala High Court also still have got a rule committee which may be functional. Mr. Ramkumar may be knowing it. The rule committee, I had also closely associated with the rule committee when I was close with the High Court. Then
223.
Exemption of some persons, 133, the vice president, ministers, judges, they are following person shall be entitled to exemption from personal appearance in court. Everybody knows exemption for members of legislative arrest, exemption of members of legislative bodies from arrest, detention under civil process. This is all these either House of Parliament member, either House of Parliament. During the 40 days before and after such meeting or conference. The language of these sub codes, these are all the one thing, whenever some dignitary VIP is a respondent or anything, you must, even if a notice is to be issued, you must issue it to notice in the form of a letter giving the details, and they should address properly and respect the recipient. And that is to be followed. Sometimes it is not being done by the judicial officer because out of ignorance. The application for restitution also, you know what is the order, these are. Then go through the various orders. I will straight away go to order 1, rule 8, publication is a public matter. The notice should be issued to all. Where there are numerous persons having the same interest in one suit, one or more of such persons may, with the permission of the court, sue or be sued. If it is a public relating to a road or relating to a church or anything, Order 1, Rule 8 publication. The court should issue the notice, must be published, and the court shall allow the Alladesh to be a party. Those who are desirous to become the defendant, they should, decree would be binding on them. Any person whose behalf or for whose benefit the suit is instituted, defendant, may apply to the court to made a party. There should be public notice. Sometimes the public notice is to be issued, and decree passed in suit under this shall be binding on all persons on whose behalf, on or whose benefit the suit is instituted. So the Order 1, Rule 8 publication, sometimes the newspaper, the publication is individual, not notice not published. The possible newspaper is published and newspaper having publication in that locality should be the misjoinder, non-joinder of no suit shall be defeated by reason of the misjoined or non-joined parties. But only thing is the non-joinder of necessary parties is very crucial. If it is a necessary party and he is not impreted as a party, it is crucial. Otherwise, the misjoined and non-joined party could be joined at any time. So a party can suit in name of wrong plaintiff and all these are. Then the order 2, rule 2 is a relinquishment of a claim where the plaintiff omits to sue in respect of intentionally relinquish any portion of such claim. He shall not afterwards sue in respect of the portion of so omitted or relinquished. So sometimes the objection regarding order 2, rule 2 objection is usually raised by the parties because he has not raised it. So he ought to have raised that he has not raised. So in the order two, the suit to include the whole claim in a suit, the whole claim should have. If he failed to include any claim, that he ought to have. So he cannot later claim. So then joinder of cause of action, certain cause of action should be joined together. Claims to be joined, recover, removal of property, certain claims. Then the order 3 is not very agents and pleaders, appearance of parties, the advocates appear, issue and service. Order 5 is service of summons. Very important, as I stated, service of summons is, the service of summons is important when order and rule 13 application is filed. When the question, somebody has been set as party and says that he had not received a summons from the court, then the question, delivery of summons by the court, whether it was effected, how it was effected, whether the pune, process server had come to his place The so when the it is to be whether the procedure prescribed under Rule 9 has been followed. Service of may be made by delivering a transmitting copy thereof by a registered post when it is physically defendant or his agent had refused to take delivery to the postal article containing some. The suppose the, his agent is there, he has refused to take delivery, refused to accept the summons by other means specified. When tendered or transmitted in the court issuing summons shall declare that summons has been duly served. So the, then the report comes to the court declare that he summons has been properly served and he is set as party. So when he comes back, comes wants set aside as party, or whether these provisions are been complied with. Only in that way, the order, the service of summons usually becomes, sometimes the evidence set as party, sometimes detailed evidence are taken. But the summons, you want a plaintiff service, that is only very crucial in the sense that the summons, how the service of summons is been effected, whether really the, then there is substituted service, where the court is satisfied, there is reason to believe that the defendant is keeping out of the way for the purpose of avoiding service, or that any other person summons cannot be served. The court shall order summons to be served by affixing copy thereof in some conspicuous place in the courthouse and also upon some conspicuous part of the house in which the defendant is known to have last resided or carried on business or personally worked for gain or in such other manner as the court thinks fit. So the substituted service, if the defendant refused to keep out of the way for the purpose of avoiding service, then the substituted service also is possible. That is only the order 5, the important. Order 6 is pleadings. Generally, the all pleadings, how the pleadings, material facts, all material facts should be pleaded, and the it should be the forms of pleadings. And now the denial is important. Denial should be not very casual denial, but it should be no evasive denial. The pleading bare denial by the same by opposite shall be construed only as a denial of fact and express contract, a matter of fact from which the same may be pleaded legally or substantially in law for such. So the denial must be specific. Denial of the, that is why the written statement, every paragraph, every allegations made in the plaintiff is denied and all these order things. Order 6, the other provision is order 6, the then 15, 16 and 17, both are the other. 15 is verification of pleadings. You must know how the pleading should be verified. The person pleadings, you know, pleadings, first of all, you must know what is pleading. Pleading and is the plaintiff and written statement. Pleading shall, they are the pleadings for the plaintiff and written statement. The other petitions and all, they are not. The pleading shall be verified. The rule 15 says that the should be verified. The person verifying shall specify by reference to the numbered paragraphs or the pleading what he verifies his own knowledge and what he verifies upon information received and believed to be true. So he must specifically the paragraph 1 to 6 I personally know, paragraph 7 to 10 I verified the content there I know from the source of information. If there is anything he can, he must say that the upon verifying the pleading he shall also furnish an affidavit in support of his will. It must be in the form of an affidavit. Then the section 60, rule 16 is striking down the pleadings. Sometimes the this power also is to be invoked. Sometimes the scandalous and frivolous and vexatious pleadings are sometimes included. Sometimes the unnecessary party is impleaded as parties. Then the court can say, no, you cannot implead this person. He is unnecessarily made. He is only defamed him. Or if some allegations are made which are not very true or which may be true but is not required for the just decision of the case, those are scandalous. If it is scandalous, certainly the court should order striking out the pleadings. But normally it may not result in striking down bleeding. He tell the plaintiff, you please remove it. We don't want to have these sort of things in your place. So immediately they will agree normally. So then they study. Then the most crucial amendment of pleadings. Everybody knows what the court may at any stage of the proceedings allow either party to alter, amend its pleading in such manner and such thing as may be just, and such amendment shall be made as may be necessary for the purpose of determining the real questions in controversy between the parties. To decide the real dispute with the parties can be allowed to amend the pleading at any stage of the suit. Even the appeal stage, the party can be allowed to, but no, shall be allowed after the trial has commenced, unless the court comes to conclusion that in spite of due diligence, the party could not have. The party has to, later stage, when it is filed at a later stage, party should establish that he had no opportunity to come to, or he had not come to know of these facts, these facts were not to his knowledge. So that is why he was unable to produce to give these included in the pleading. Then the court will give time to amend allow the amendment to be carried out, and sometimes the fresh written statement plain is to be filed. The order 7 is plain to everyone, and nowadays there are all these cause of action should be stated, the plaintiff, defendant, and if it is an unsound mind, minor person, that is also to be stated. When you allow set of relinquish all these the order. Then the main written statement, set off on counterclaim, how the set off on counterclaim is raised in the written statement, if it is a counterclaim or set off, the counterclaim is to be treated as a plaint, and the notice is to be issued to all the pleadings relating to pleading, the defendant, the plaintiff has to file, delay that. Then the specific, all these, it is to be stated, set off should be written statement, shall have the same effect as a plaint in a crossword. So the set off, if the defendant has raised the set off, appearance of what? The consequence of order 9, the consequence of party is the order 9, rule. Plaintiff default of fresh suit, order 9 rule 13 setting aside DS party. Everybody knows order 9 rule 13 applications. The decree, the ex party decree to be set aside, the examination of parties, discovery and inspection. Then the admission notice of admission of parties issues. These are all issues and all you, everybody summoning of attendance of witness. And then the execution is the main, order 39, all these appointment receiver, appointment of injunction applications and all, everybody knows judgment and decree, how the judgment is to be, they all these. So these are all execution, we have to pay attention to how these that is to be closely, you must read and understand the execution procedure. So the setting aside sale, if there is a sale, deposit the amount that is also, suppose the party who was successful bidder has not deposited the money in time, so sale could be set aside. Then a third party whose property is sold without his knowledge, thinking that it was defendant's property, he can come and file application. Then fraud and illegality in the material irregularity in the sale. Then on that ground also, these are the three stage which the sale is to be set aside. That is one important. Death, marriage, and insolvency of parties. So the marriage does in effect, death, parties, abatement. The party is, now they, suppose the defendant is, the defendant died and the counsel has got a responsibility to inform the court that his party, So it will be deemed his wakalat. Even if he died, his that contract continued. And the duty of the pleader to communicate the court death of a party. That one should be aware. Whenever the pleader appearing for a party to suit comes to know the death of that party, he shall inform the court about it. And court shall thereupon give notice to such death or party. And for the purpose of contract between the pleader and deceased party shall be deemed to subsist. So then the withdrawal of suit, if there is any material suit must be filed for some formal defect, then so party can withdraw the suit. There is sufficient grounds for allowing the plaintiff to institute fresh suit, subject matter suit for party. So these are all withdrawal and adjustment of suits. The abatement, if the party cause of action survives the death of a plaintiff, defense shall not cause the suit to abate if the right issue survives. If the right issue survives, the suit will not abate. So the procedure in case of death of one or several plaintiffs or plaintiff, all these are all abatement. The set aside abatement, party can implead the LRs. So set aside the procedure where there is no legal representative, then the court, this is important for no legal representative. Court can, even then, the court can appoint a person who has no interest in the subject matter of the suit, shall ascertain that person proposed to be appointed representative. So then the suit can be disposed of. You know. So I hope appointment receiver, these are all appointment receiver commission and all not. These are all there. You must, whenever an opportunity gets, this CPC is your Bible for the civil officers. You must constantly read CPC and whenever the opportunity, use it. So, if you understand the 11th provision in the correct perspective, the CPC, you will be a good civil officer. No? And Ram Kumar and all, he has argued several cases touching the CPC and the civil matters before me, and I am glad.
I am now a confirmed criminal.
But in those days,
yes,
you are only arguing. You, Shankaran, these. Okay, Mr. Premraj, this is.
Division. Wonderful, sir.
Yes, sir, it is wonderful.
A run through, a cover to cover run through of CPC, a bird's eye view of CPC, sir, I would say.
May I ask one question? Don't you think that a person who is applying for a judicial service should have compulsory bar service, bar experience?
That is a. Mr. Adi, I can say, I hope this is, it is necessary. But unfortunately, I am also a party to that.
I'm sorry.
No, Adi, nothing. Myself and Justice Kripal was not the final order, but it was. Justice Kripal was very strong in the views. Because whenever some matters come, they are the whole country's perspective is must be known. So, but I feel that here the situation is after the law exam is over, then they straight away study for the civil. Civil service, this is a judicial service selection. Straight away. They don't go to court. So, but that is a practice. And they initially commit, they have knowledge, initially commit some mistakes, both civil and criminal. Sometimes they're good intention, good judges. But unfortunately, it happens. So, we can, somebody can take it up. So that is not a final thing. Nothing is final in law.
My lord, with permission, I want your lordship's valuable opinion on one aspect.
What?
Recording of evidence is contained in CPC, Order 18, Rule 4. Presently, it is permissible to file affidavits so far as chief examination is concerned. But at least for private witnesses, non-party witnesses, I think the chief examination must be led in open court. Say, for example, a document is a compulsorily attestable document like will. If a chief affidavit of the attestor is filed, the purpose is lost, my lord, is it not? I want your lordship's valuable opinion on this.
This amendment, they thought that the time of chief examination could be curtailed. But even in some arbitration matters, what in the form of chief examination now they file is the entire pleadings and the evidence and all. So a witness you could have finished within one day is being cross-examined for 10 days, 15 days, 20 days. Because the chief examination, everything is stated. And if it is not cross-examined, that amounts to something. But generally, the chief examination, they only state that I have filed the plaint and these are all the relevant things. It would be over. In an ordinary suit, chief examination would be 2 or 3 pages and would be end within half an hour. Now, it is cross-examination runs to several days. An amendment is, as you rightly said, create a huge problem.
And advocate commissions, they take, they don't curtail the cross-examination. When the party is examined by an advocate commission, they don't curtail the cross-examination. They cannot ask any, they cannot disallow questions.
And normally because they
that's
are
to the delay. That's to the delay.
But that is not a very ordinary one. Sometimes it. Anybody want to in subject related? Anybody?
Sir. One expert. Sir, good evening, sir. Recording of evidence by on commission, the old method of the court recording the demeanor of the witness is gone, sir. The commissioner doesn't record it because the demeanor of a witness is most important, especially how the witness commits to next question is normally recorded in case it is done in the open court. The benefit of how the conduct of the witness is lost now by virtue of having an advocate commissioners for recording the cross-exam. Your comment on that, sir?
That will be there, always there. But in civil cases, what is there? How are we concerned with the demeanor? In criminal case, it is we are really concerned. If the witness says if he is a tutored witness or a wrong witness, we can on the face of it, he's a good judicial officer can session judge can know that. But civil case, what is the how are we are not much bothered about the. Demeanor and the demeanor can also be pretended. They may be fake demeanor.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Nagamuthu, sir. So you are unmute. Yes, sir. Please unmute.
No, except thanking his lordship, I got nothing to ask.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Yeah, Prem.
Yes, sir. It was a very brilliant encapsulation of the topic and the power of your professional wisdom has been articulated at its finest. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for
thank you.
Thank you. Everybody, that brings us to the end of the 48th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction lecture series. We are deeply indebted to you, sir, for accepting our invitation and addressing us today. we are equally indebted to Justice V. Ramkumar sir, Nagamuthu sir, and Murthy sir for their valuable presence, and to each and every one of you for being part of this journey of legal discovery. Thank you very much. Till we meet again tomorrow 3:30, please take care, stay safe. Thank you very much.